The fifth unit, which talks about different, it talks about different topics. This is very, very small unit, just two or three topics is covered, and I'll share the PPT for the same. Is the slide visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
My voice is
yes, ma'am.
My voice is audible, right? Shall we start?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, okay. So this is the fifth unit in organizational behavior. So only four topics is covered. One is management approaches. Second is Japanese management. Third one is entrepreneurial management. And fourth one is benchmarking. See, if you see in this topic, you may get a question in about the Japanese management. And the first topic is management approach. On these two topics, you may get. And rarely you may get the third and fourth topic also. Entire unit is like a vague topic. It's not as interesting as your previous unit. So we'll see that one by one. So first one, management approaches. As I said in motivation and leadership, here also there are n number of approaches in management. So in your book, certain approaches are given, and if you read this, actually in the material, they didn't give what the approaches say. As an introduction, as a paragraph, they have given, but what is the main aim of that approach? What the approach is trying to say? They didn't mention that. So just understand what I want to say is, like here, so whenever I take a topic, I'll say that in one line, so that if I say that one line, you can write on your own words if you understand that one line. So I'll say each and every approach in one line, what it is trying to say, right? And in that, the first one is management approaches. The first approach is human relation approach. Human relation approach is the first one. As the term itself indicates, you need to have that approach. So a manager or a leader, whoever it is. Here we are talking about the approach, not the leader or anybody. Anybody it might be, but what approach or what practice they are following. Either the management or a particular person or an individual. In human relation approach, either it may be the manager or the leader, what he will do or how the he follows this human relation approach. As the term indicates, what how they will be. It the study is all about the people's behavior at the work environment, in the organization, how the people behave or how the employer or employee behave. That is your human relation approach. One line is how the people, or it is the study of it is the study of people's behavior at work, right? And now this is one thing. On the other side, this theory is giving some relationship between your social factor and the productivity. This is the second point. I said the people's behavior is monitored, or we are studying that one. How it is monitored, or how we are studying that theory. Yes, here two terms is involved. One is about social factor and the other side is productivity. So as a manager or as a leader, you should balance these two, social factor and productivity. This is the new concept. But earlier, before all these approaches, what the management will do?
Ma'am?
Yes?
Ma'am, screen not visible, ma'am.
It's not visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Now is it okay?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. In human relation approach, I said the people's behavior is studied, and here earlier only productivity is given importance, but nowadays the social factors should be given importance. If social needs are given importance, then automatically the employee in the organization will work and it will lead to better productivity. So this is the concept they are saying. So social factor on one side and productivity on the other side. Earlier we focused only on productivity, but now today we need to give importance for the social factor. What is the social factor? Like giving some satisfaction or social relation means you should be like a participative leadership. Like you need to satisfy them personally or socially. So obviously they will work for the organization, then their productivity will increase. So this is this concept. The human resource is the important asset in the organization. Right. So the human resource should be given importance. The relationship should be good. So healthy human resource leads to increased productivity and efficiency. This is what this approach is saying. So don't give importance only for production or productivity. Give importance for the social factor also. That is called human relation approach. Then the second one is Hawthorne experiment. This is slightly a bigger concept. If you browse or if you see in your book also, there are four phases they are given. Phase 1, 2, 3 and 4. See, this is also a theory or approach. But how he is a person, Hawthorne. He has experimented and found a solution called Hawthorne experiment. Or we can say Hawthorne effect. They say as Hawthorne effect or sometime experiment. See, during a particular period from 1924 to 27, he studied one experiment. He made a research. So if you see the part 1 to part 4, the year is mentioned. So during that period, he experienced and he made a research of identifying one thing. Now it is explained in your book also, but I'll say in short, in a humiliation experiment, he also concentrate on human relation only. Humiliation means the light or the place where light comes from. It is a brightness. It indicates some brightness or light. So what this at this experiment, what he found out is, it was revealed that productivity could be increased not only by increasing the work environment, but through informal social relation. See, first theory is you need to focus on social factor. Here also he identified the same thing. What he found out is, rather than giving importance, if work environment is good, people will not work together. It's not that only work environment is good, people will go for better productivity. No, that is not true. Though you have a very good work environment, though you have well sufficient infrastructure and everything, people might not work if the social factor or social needs are satisfied. This is the one he found out in part one. So again, the same thing. Social needs or social relations should be given importance, even though the work environment is good. That is the first one. And secondly, in the second experiment, again he is pointing out this theory is also about human relation only, but he has proved everything in three, four phases. Right? In the second one also, several new elements were introduced in work environment, such as if work and in the work environment, if you are giving shorter working hours and some proper rest period and improving their physical condition, friendly supervision, if all these some factors or some elements, if you are increasing in the work environment, even though that is increased, the productivity may increase only a little bit. See, again the same point he is saying. First also he said, even though there is good work environment, you need to give importance for the relation, public, sorry, human relation. Again, the same thing he is repeating in the second phase also. What he is saying is he has introduced new elements in the work environment, and he proved that even though you increase certain work environment in a proper way, you need to give some importance to the human relation also. Like that, that is the second one. And the third phase, and third phase is mass interviewing program. Here a large number of workers were interviewed to know their perception and orientation on the working life. So they are calling and asking about the perception, how was the working life environment, like that they were calling and asking. There was some research on that, and what the result is saying is informal work group is recognized. Informal work group is identified or recognized. Like there is some informal group which obviously be there in an organization. That is the third research he found out from that. And again, the fourth one is also same. A group of 14 workers was observed with regard to their work behavior. In for third point, he observed that there is some informal group, and he proved whether it is yes or no. So that is the fourth one. He called 14 workers, and he observed their work behavior. The observation revealed the informal production norms set by the workers, and the existence, and there is the existence of informal relationship in the group. So this is the fourth thing he found out. You can write this if the question is asked, because it is rather than other approach, this approach is little bit important when other approaches compared, right? So I'm just explaining what is that. First two is saying about the human relation. Though you give importance to the work environment, you need to give concentration on the human relation also. Last two is saying that there is an informal work group which will be present in the work environment. That is the last two phases it is he is explaining. Okay, whatever he experimented, what is the outcome?
Excuse me, ma'am. Ma'am?
Yes.
Ma'am, screen not visible, ma'am.
Findings of Hawthorne effect. Can you see this slide? No?
No, ma'am.
No, oh God. Wait. Now, okay. Findings of Hawthorne effect.
Okay, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So, whatever the phases he explained, now the result is, the findings from this experiment is, people work is dependent on social issues and job satisfaction, right? So, overall finding is, they need some social needs and some job satisfaction or job securities rather than whatever the work environment, whatever elements you add up in the work environment. This is the thing they want. And people are giving less importance for the incentive and the working condition, as I said. So whatever you improve, whatever you give, they are giving less importance for that. And finally, people are giving importance only for meeting individuals' desire. They want their desire to be satisfied. That is the outcome of this Hawthorne experiment or Hawthorne effect. First approach and second are both are similar. But first he said in the human relation approach, this is right away, this is the content or this is the theory he talks about. But in the second one, he experimented, he made a research and found out this is the solution, right? And is this visible system approach? Now, the next approach is called system approach. Is this visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. System approach is only one term. The entire work, the set of interrelated work and that is separated by different system or department. If you see the diagram, you will understand the concept. System means something systematically organized, centralized. You can use an n number of terms. Everything is centralized or systematic, or it is like a flow of a chart. The organization structure is good. You can say whatever it is. System approach means everything, the manager should be organized as a whole. He takes decision only after analyzing each department. Everything is systematic. And here, system, it includes different departments. Right, so he gets information from each department, and one information, department A information will be input for department B. Based on that input, they work and they will give some output, and that output will be the information for the other department. So everything is like a system. So you need to follow a systematic approach after analyzing each and every department. So everything is interrelated. So you should have a system should be interacting, right? That is your system approach. I have given the meaning for it. And if this is asked, you draw this diagram, and the features of that system approach is also given. And in your book, there are certain terms included in system approach, subsystem and synergy, open system. That is the concept which is involved in system approach. But I didn't add those content in this slide. If you see in your book, page number 295, it is here. It is just the content or the topic which will come under the system approach. Then, contingency approach. Here you need to use only two words. What is that is, this approach is also called situational approach or common sense approach. So this, at this time, you need to use your sense, or depending upon the situation or the circumstances, the organization will operate accordingly. This is the meaning. So contingency approaches, the system or the procedure or whatever you are framing, that you need to do after seeing or depending upon the situation or circumstances, you will change the organization structure accordingly. So how organization operate under various situation and circumstances, this is the meaning. This would be the best way, because you are based on the situation and circumstances you are framing the policies, right? So this will be the best approach than the other approach. So they may state this approach is the best one. In the first line I have given, right, the best way. So yeah, seeing the situation and circumstances, this tells to know the technique, which technique should be used, because on that particular situation you are analyzing. So this would be the better one than the other. This is contingency approach. Then, quantitative approach. Here, quantitative approach means using certain techniques, mathematical or statistical techniques, or whatever techniques that is updated. So you need to use that approach. That is your quantitative, like systematically, rather than using your own styles and approaches, you need to update yourself with the upcoming technology and upcoming tools and techniques which will be used in the organization. So you need to update. So quantitative means some mathematical or statistical techniques that should be used as by the managers or the leader for betterment of the organization. That is quantitative approach. So far we have seen different approaches, human relation, giving importance for social factor and productivity, balancing social factor and productivity. And second one is Hawthorne experiment. Here also, rather than giving or people are giving more importance for their social needs than their work environment, whatever the work environment is. System approaches, everything is systematic, interacted, interrelated, and it has different departments. Contingency approaches, like everything, it's based on organization will take decision based on the situation and circumstances. And quantitative means using mathematical and statistical techniques. That is all about your management approaches. Is it okay? Then, is this slide visible? Japanese management?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. The next heading is Japanese management. This is very like a normal topic only, but don't see what would be the content in that Japanese management. This is nothing, whatever we are following. Now here, see, we are telling that all these features are included in Japanese management, or the Japanese, they are following all these policies and procedures in their management. See, if we talk about our country with the Japanese people, we'll all obviously wonder, right, they are like this, they are like that. So the theory also talking about Japanese management, but nothing new, everything the same topic. So that is, rather than giving introduction about Japanese management, I've given the features, because in the entire features talks about what the Japanese management is. So you can just put an heading like this and write, and if at all feature is asked, you can write as the same content. If you see the introduction or the concept of Japanese management, the same will be covered everywhere. So put together, I have given 10 features. So I'll explain one by one so that you'll understand the concept itself. So what Japanese management is saying is, first one is lifetime employment. So features, and saying its features, 10 features. And at that, the first one is lifetime employment. What is lifetime employment? What they are actually following, their techniques, that is your features. So they are following lifetime employment. What is that is, here the employment to the worker is lifelong, their job is secured, their job is secured, and they feel free that they have their job till their life end. That is they are saying, telling us lifetime employment. So they are not asking any workers to go out or sending out. So to that extent, they are recruiting quality employees and keeping them in their environment, in their work organization till their life end. Right, that is your lifetime employment. They have this feature, but other organization, they may send out, all these happens, right? So what Japanese are following, they are giving lifetime employment for a particular person if he is fully qualified, right? And the second one is discrimination. Actually, in the organization, there will be a discrimination among people in the workplace. Normally in India, no, you have this discrimination. The male will have all those secured job, but female, they don't have. Even if a female is unmarried, she may get promotion or whatever it is, right? If married, the entire situation goes upside down. So there is some discrimination, right? So they are not following those things. So that is the second point, discrimination. And the next one is all about recruitment. As I said in the first point, since it is lifetime employment, how the recruitment process would be? It will be rigid, rigorous, since only qualified persons are recruited. So to recruit qualified people, how you will go for recruitment process? It will be very rigid and it will be very systematic. So likewise, they are recruiting. And the next point is seniority wage principle. Here, what they are following is wage is paid based on seniority. Right? So based on seniority, they are paying their wages or salary. Like you can use the term loyalty. So if you are working in an organization for more than 10 or 20 years, what your wage will be? It will get increased day by day, year by year, right? So they are using that strategy, seniority wage policy. So that is the concept. And the next one, see, if I say each and every point, you can fix what the Japanese management or approach is talking about. So all these features they have put together, they term this as this is the policy. Yes,
is this available in the book also, these features?
Yeah, in your book it is given, the topic is there, but they have given in different way, like about Japanese management, but not as clear as here. I have given like a feature, but in your book they have given like focus. 1 minute. Is this visible and my voice is audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Ah, yes. See, in your book, they have given some strategies, techniques and all. But if you read and see whatever I said, it will be covered. Right?
Okay, ma'am.
1 minute. So, where I left...
employee.
So next point is all about employee involvement. Employee involvement means the decision making. In decision making, the employees are involved. They are taken into consideration. So normally in India or in other country, they may take or they may not. That depends upon the organization. But in Japanese management, they are taking the employee in the decision-making process also. That is employee involvement. So employees are involved in taking decision. That is the another feature. The next one is employee welfare. So here in Japanese management, the organization is giving some welfare packages like healthcare, giving some allowances, house rent allowance and loan facilities. All these are some welfare packages. See, that is your employee welfare. And the next one is internal labor market. Here, what is the internal labor market means? Since I said no seniority wage principle, so here internally they are recruiting the people for certain position. If I want some position should be filled, I may not go for recruiting the people. Since in the recruitment process itself, I recruited people with well-qualified one. So what I do is I'll promote them in the seniority basis, right? So they are following a promoting the employee internally rather than recruiting from outside. This is called internal labor market. So internally you are taking the employee and promoting in the respective position rather than going for outside recruitment. So in the first feature itself, we saw the recruitment will be very systematic and rigid, right? So they have sorted the people. So accordingly, they will allocate in the new position. That is this. And the next one is continuous training. So here, the people, the employees are given with continuous training. Now here, each and every person in a Japanese firm, the manager has a person above him called a godfather. He may not be called as a boss or any authoritative person, but he will be like a well-wisher. He's guiding the young manager. This is a practice they are following. He may not be the top management or authoritative person. He'll be like a well-wisher or as a term used as a godfather. So he will get the guidance from those people and he'll be moving the younger managers or the younger people who are being appointed. This is all about continuous training. So that person is giving training to the newer one or the young people who is being appointed. Then the last two topics about good benefit for employees. This is as same as the welfare measure. So the benefit is given to the employee, like allowances, perks, accommodation, salary benefit, bonus, or anything. Here, what they are doing, salary benefit means if he worked in an organization for more than 7 years, or once he completed 7 years, his salary will be hiked. So since I said it is a lifetime employment, 7 years, once he completed 7 years, he will be promoted or his salary will be hiked. This is the benefit, different benefit they are giving. And finally, this concept is very simple and flexible. They are saying this, all these concept or the structure, the entire Japanese management structure is very flexible and people take new challenges by their own way and they will work accordingly. So this is all about totally 10 features I have listed. This is the concept about Japanese management. See, if we read all 10, even when in India, here also we are following the same. Nothing new in this. So everything is same everywhere, but only the content is they are using as a Japanese management. Since it is a concept, you just understand this all 10 topics. You can write if at all the question is asked to discuss about Japanese management, like a paragraph, you can write. So Japanese management is following this strategy, this policy, this approach, like this, you can just write. And taking all these 10 points into consideration, you take the book and see, everything will be covered. They have given two topics like strategy, focus, and techniques. In three terms, they calcified and given. But I have given you like features, 10 features. Right? This is about Japanese management. Now the slide is visible. Creativity and innovation. Yes, this is all about just the meaning, what is creativity and what is innovation. You know, creativity, simply I can say you deal with the reality, creatively doing. That depends on the circumstances, how creatively you are performing, right? Innovation means you sit and decide like innovatively, what new ideas can be brought into in the organization. So creative and innovation, more or less it is same, but if you see, so you need to inculcate new idea, that is innovation, and creative is just depending on the situation and the lifestyle. You deal with the reality, that is your creativity. Just make a note of it, just what it is. Then the next topic is entrepreneurial management. And the last topic is benchmarking. That's it, your unit 5. Yes. Your slide is visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Now, this topic, entrepreneurial management, I'll say what is, maybe you may get a question from here, this topic, entrepreneurial management, what is it? You can write, this is very interesting topic. Entrepreneur, I think you might know. Entrepreneur is a person who do some innovative ideas, start up a venture and do something new. That is called an entrepreneur. He should have all the abilities. So that is the person who is coming with the new ideas, starting up a new business or doing something new. That person is called entrepreneur. And doing that process and the action of entrepreneur, who is a person in search of something new, doing that process is called entrepreneurship. And some of the features of entrepreneurship, you may get this question, entrepreneurship features or the qualities of entrepreneur. So what he need to have and what qualities he need to have, or what is the features of entrepreneurship? Economic and dynamic activity, and all about innovation. Entrepreneurship means, or entrepreneur should be a person with new ideas, that is called innovation, and profit potential, and other important term is risk bearing. Since he is a small size business he is having. Entrepreneur comes from a smaller level to the upper level. So he need to bear his own risk. He need to accept the challenges, whatever coming. And again, innovation is added. And the decision making, he need to sit and decide. Right. So you don't have any n number of employees. If he is a initial entrepreneur starting with a new business, then he need to decide everything. The process is not, I think, given in your book. It is here. But you can write the process in your own way. How an entrepreneurship or entrepreneurial process starts from. First, you need to have an idea. Like if you are going to start up a small business or if you are going to do something, now you will set an idea. Right? First, you need to fix the idea. Then you have to get the recognition. Like it should be approved and said okay by some people. That is the second one. And the other most, one most important concept is feasibility. Feasibility means you are doing your study and identifying which will be the best. If four ways there, you need to select one among the four. That is your feasibility study in all the dimension, financially, economically, technically, and everything. You need to find out whether your idea you planned will work it out. That is your feasibility study. If you are started, if you are going to start up a new business like a manufacturing a toys or whatever it is, then you need to do the feasibility study. Will it be okay in different dimension? That is your feasibility study. And finally, you go for elimination and verification. And your last topic. And if you see your book, benchmarking also, it has given about meaning, advantages and disadvantages. It is there in your book. Just see the background of benchmarking. They have given what is benchmark definition, everything. But here I have given only the meaning and types and process. But if you see the book, you can see the advantage and disadvantages also. Now I'll say what is benchmarking. Simply a term I can say is benchmarking means fixing a standard, or you're comparing your actual with the standard. Benchmark, fixing the standard, that is your benchmark. It's a point of reference against which things are measured. You're fixing something and you're comparing yours with that, the measures, right? That is benchmarking is. So to see the paragraph, benchmarking is used to identify your gap. What is the gap? What is your performance? What is the benchmark you fixed or what you are taking as a standard? Then you need to compare so that you will identify the gap. So that gap will be useful for correcting the measures. That is your benchmark. You have different types of benchmark. The different types means internal, external, and competitive. Internal benchmark is the process where you are fixing the benchmark within the organization. So within the organization, how you will compare the performance of similar business unit or business process. So you will compare internally. So you will pick some standard or benchmark, not outside the organization, inside you will compare and accordingly you will perform. That is the internal. External means you will compare with the other one, other organization or other competitors. Externally, the external factors will be included here. So you will fix that as a standard, that as a benchmark, and you'll proceed. And competitive benchmark is same as the external one. Here only the comparison is made with those of competitors alone. External means competitors, creditors, or every person outside the organization is external only. Your economic factors, technical factors will be included. But in competitive benchmarking, you are taking the comparison of competitors alone. Right? So you are fixing. If you want to do something more production than the other company which is nearby you, then that is your competitors benchmarking. And the last topic is about process of benchmarking. Then how you will fix the benchmark. So what is the process involved? First, you need to plan. To fix the benchmark also, you need to plan first. So what objective you have? So for that, what should be kept as benchmark or as a measure? That is the first one. What you want to improve? So that is your planning is. And second one is collection of information. So here, based on the standard you fixed, you collect the information. You are looking to improve your customer satisfaction or understanding of different departments. Now you need to, so depends upon the planning, you need to collect information. And finally, based on the information, you analyze. You compare and analyze based on the data you got, right? So you may use different tools also for analyzing this one, mathematical or statistical tool, or whatever you can use. And after analyzing, you will monitor. You will get the solution, right? You will get some answer. So based on the answer, if it is okay, you can continue. If it is not okay, you check for the gap, what the gap is or what the deviation is. Then accordingly, you will go for taking corrective measure. So you need to go with the, or next, after monitoring, you can say as feedback. So you need to go like this. So first one is planning, you go for information, then analyzing those information, then taking corrective measures, or feedback is the last process, and benchmarking. So that's it. Your slide is over. This is all about benchmarking. So we discussed about management approaches, totally 5 approaches we saw, and about Japanese management. I said 10 features of Japanese management, then general concept of entrepreneurship, and the process characteristics we saw. And in benchmarking, we saw the meaning and different types and the process, right? Is this okay? Your fifth unit. With this, your subject, management concept and organizational behavior is over. Your last topic unit will be somewhat vague, but your first, second, all those units will be interesting. So just make a note of it. I'll share my PPT in the group. I just forgot yesterday. Today I'll share, but I'll share from unit 2 to 5. Yes, right, because in the first unit I didn't share any PPT, I didn't prepare. So unit 2 to 5 I'll share in the group, in I think 2019 group, right?
Yes.
So I'll share after this class.
Thanks.
Is this okay, useful? You got some idea?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, I have doubt. Ma'am, whatever PPT you shared, no, ma'am, in that, whatever topics are there, if we study that for exam, is it enough?
Yeah, that is okay. This, okay. I have covered 80%, you know, at the maximum, okay. We can 99% also. Only the minor topic, like if I talk about in this unit creativity and innovation, I have just said the meaning of it. I didn't leave any topic in your book. So at the maximum, 90% I covered.
Okay. Ma'am, in the book, behind questions are there, right, ma'am? Those questions, if we refer, is it fine for the exam preparation?
Yeah. Now how you need to prepare is, take the book and take my PPT, just prepare what I have given. And on the other side, you take the question paper and see. Because in the question paper, the topic will be very little content in the book. Now, if I say what is organization climate, Now, we didn't talk about organizational climate much. I said, what is that? But what happens in the question, if you see what is organizational climate, discuss, or what are all the types they may ask? That is not in your book also, but they may ask. This is unexpected question. And we cannot cover all the topic in in-depth manner, right? So this happens in the exam, but nothing to worry. Just take my PPT because I covered at the maximum and prepare accordingly. If you see 3 to 4 question paper, that will give a broad idea for you. So this would be the question paper. So this is the pattern they are asking. And mostly at the maximum, you will get direct question only.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay. So all the best for your exam. Prepare well.
Actually, thank I you. Tried calling this number, but no one, it was going continuously engaged. Is there any direct number or anything to call for the question paper? Or if you can,
someone
like...
Someone is messaging in the group asking for exam and everything. DDE office number. They were added in the group, right? You called to that number.
That is not a working number, no ma'am. It's only for WhatsApp, no?
Oh, yes, yes.
Yeah.
Even that number, okay. DDE office, they have created this group, right?
Uh-huh, okay.
Because I am seeing the message you are asking for the timetable and the class.
Yeah, I only asked for the question paper. No one responded actually.
I don't know what to do because they need to answer this, right? Okay, yeah, if possible, I'll also call them because I have I know 2-3 faculty in DDE. Let me ask them to give some solution for you.
Okay.
Okay. Okay then. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for your cooperation. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Good evening.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, sir.
Good
Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Whether I have to go for explanation of all those things or on straight away we will go to the important questions. Which one is needed? Because we have only 4-5 hours. Until that we have to finish. It is almost we reached 4th unit to 5th unit. So there are certain acts that we need to see. So that acts we will touch it. After that we will come to this important questions. Okay. Here, another, actually in the last class we saw about the contract act. Contract act, what is contract, what is offer, what is acceptance, all those things we saw. We saw in this contract act. And the next act is called a Negotiable Instrument Act 1981. Under this Negotiable Instrument Act, we are going to see about the various bill of exchanges. Like a promissory note, check, okay. So these are the main documents which have been used for transaction. Getting funds or say, giving money. Okay, for that we are using certain kind of a bill of exchange. What is bill of exchange? Bill of exchange is an instrument in writing containing an unconditional order signed by the maker, directing a certain person to pay certain amount of money on the order, only on the order. And to those who are bearing the instrument, for that we are going to make the payment. Okay, that kind of instrument are called a bill of exchange. And also promissory note is also, it's like the same thing. And also check. Check, you know very well, it is a person who is going to bearing the check, he is responsible to get the money out of that instrument. That is called a check. Okay. Even certain they may ask what is the difference between the promissory note and a bill of exchange. Sometimes bill of exchange and a check. We have a what is the main difference? Just we see that promissory note and bill of exchange. Distinction is, there are only two parties in the promissory note. Okay, debtor and creditors. Bill of exchange, we have three parties. That is drawer, drawee and payee. Okay. And then in case of a promissory note, it contains an unconditional promise by the maker to pay the payee. And whereas in the bill of exchange contains an unconditional order the drawee to pay according to the drawer's direction. And here in this promissory note, no prior acceptance is needed. Whereas in this exchange, you need a prior acceptance that I am going to present, give it to somebody else from the drawer to drawee. For that, they will collect the money. So like that, the bill of exchange is having their own features. Okay. And then in case of bill of exchange and check, there will be some of the differences. You just read that, you can easily understood. That is called a check is made by drawn only on a banker. Okay. Whereas you can draw on any person, including a banker, by the bill of exchange. Okay. The amount is always payable on demand in this check. The amount may be payable on demand or after the specified time or period. Okay. The check is not entitled to grace period. It is not possible in the case of check. Whereas in the bill of exchange, you are going for another 3 days of grace period from which you can draw a bill. Okay. The acceptance is not needed in the case of check. The bills payable after sight must be accepted. Okay. These are some of the differences between bill of exchange and a check. And these are the various things which comes under this. What are the requisites of check? What are the importance of promissory note? What are the characteristics of promissory note? So these are all the in the check. What are the different types of crossing? General crossing, special crossing, two lines are when you are drawing means it's called a general crossing for an account payee or not negotiable and company. While you are going for the special crossing means you are going to mention about the particular name of the bank, like that if you are using means that is called a special crossing. Okay. So these are the various main important things that we will see in this chapter. Okay. In this Negotiable Instrument Act, in this these are the various things comes under this chapter. Next one is called what is the nature of a company, how it is going to form, how it is going to be formation of a new company. You know what is company means? Companies is a voluntary association of person formed for some common purpose which capital divisible into parts known as shares. Okay. What is meant by share? The share is nothing but the total capital of the companies are subdivided into various parts. Then we can call it as a share capital. Okay. What are the various characteristics of a company? That is also a very important question. Characteristics of the company. It is an incorporated association. You are going to incorporate. Incorporation is nothing but you are going to register. When you are going to register a company means you need a minimum number, maximum number of members is required. Okay. The minimum number of members are required, 7 in the case of public company, 2 in the case of private company. Okay. And for the banking business, at least 10 persons are essential. Okay. For 20 in the case of any other business. While you are going to register, these are the minimum things that you have to require for the company. And then if it is registered means that company is said to become a artificial person. If it is registered that the company has been formed means it has a separate legal entity. In the sense, what is that? It is continue forever. Okay. Separate legal entity. And then next one is called a limited liability. Is nothing but if a person who is invested the money or share capital in that company according to the value of the shares is liable, is not coming an unlimited liability. If it is an unlimited liability, you have to contribute from your private property, private income. private income. So that is not comes under limited liability. Okay, how much of extent for which you are contributed for the company, according to that value that you are made to be committed. That is called a limited liability. And next one is called a separate property. Separate property is nothing but if a company is registered, means I already told that that is an artificial person. That is a artificial, the company has become an artificial person. Though in that case, if the any property which have been bought in the sense that will be in the name of that company, even though you are the director of the company or the main managing director of a company, but is that any property which is purchased in the name of the company, it belongs to the company. So because it is having a characteristics of separate property. And then next one is called transferability of shares. If in a company, when you have purchased any shares, that it is easily transferable from one person to another person. Okay, that is done in the case of a company. Okay, and then perpetual existence. Already told that the company is being an artificial person. It is being incapability by illness, so it is does not have an allotted span of time. Okay, even all the members are died, that company never dies. That is called perpetual existence. It is goes forever. Yeah, even if you left from that company, some another member will come to the company. Okay, so that is why that is called a perpetual existence. And next one is called common seal. Common seal means is that it's a for the company, that for a general there will be some seal was created. So it is a common seal. From under that only the directors, officers, and other employees are bound to bear signature. Okay, so the common seal is the official signature of the company. And then capacity to sue. For that is nothing but I already told that it is having a separate legal entity. If we are having a separate legal entity, means even anybody who is going to sue against the company, he will act as a person. He is act as an artificial person to say sue as well as a sue against anybody, any company or any persons. You can capacity to sue. Capacity to sue on the court. Okay, so these are the main important characteristics of the company. So accordingly, what are the characteristics and what is illegal association, and then classification of companies. The classification of companies is also important. What is chartered company? What is a statutory company? Registered company, licensed company, and then foreign companies. On the base of liability, companies with limited liability, companies with guarantee, unlimited liabilities. On the base of number of members, private company, public limited company, and then on the base of control, holding company, subsidiary company. On the base of ownership, government company means is called the share capital. 51% of the share capital which have been held by the government. Okay, and then foreign company, deemed public company, one man company, non-trading company, that is for non-profit organization, okay, association, investment company, FERA companies, finance company, public financial institutions like ICICI, IFCI, IDBI, LIC, UTI, and then infrastructure development finance company. So these are all the various companies, different types of company. In case they ask that question, what are the different types of companies? These are the companies for which you have to describe. Okay. And then next one is formation. Formation of the company is also an important concept. How you are going to form a company? The form means, first of all, the promotion. The promotion is to be done by the promoter of the company. He is an initiator to promote a company. Okay, yeah, that the promoter is doing that function and next step is called the promoter is doing that function. After that, they need to register. That is a register. You have to register. What are the things that you are going to for the registration? You must register the name, and there will be some procedure for creating a memorandum of association and documents like a memorandum of association and articles of association and declaration and consent of directors. These are the some of the main documents that while you are going to registration of a company. After a registration, that the registrar office is giving a certificate that is called certificate of incorporation. Even that company, that this certificate is not enough to start a business. So, and another certificate which have been given by the registrar office, that is called certificate of commencement of business. After getting the certificate of commencement of business, then only you can start your business. Okay, so these are the various formation of business was takes place. Okay, once again I repeat that formation of business. First, the promoter who is doing the promotion. According to the promotion, what are the areas for which they must create, form, as well as club all the activities. This is the main important aspect from the promoter. The promoter who's doing the activity of registration process. In the registration process, there are some documents which are required, that is prospectus, and then memorandum of association, articles of association. So what is articles of association? Memorandum of association means the articles of associations are the documents which will be consist of internal affairs of the company. Internal affairs of the company. And then for the memorandum of association, it's a document which consists of external affairs of the company. External affairs of the company. Okay, see these documents which have been registered with the register office. And apart from that, there will be a lot of documents. You have to get a signature from the director, name and addresses. A lot of things are there. So you just add all those things in the at the time of registration. Finally, they will give a certificate of incorporation, and then the flotation was takes place. After that, a certificate of commencement of business. After getting the certificate of commencement of business, you may start a company by the public sectors. Okay, so these are the ways of formation of business. Okay, accordingly you have to explain. This is the lesson number 2, which consists of what is memorandum of association, articles of association, their contents, what are the name clause, register clause, objects clause, liability clause, capital clause, association clause. So what are the which are main clauses which are coming in this articles and memorandum of association which is come in this part. Okay, next one is articles of association. And this third lesson is about prospectus. I already told that prospectus. What is prospectus? Prospectus is an invitation. It is a document or is an invitation to the public that is giving a notice or circular or advertisement through which the deposits from the publics has been invited for the purchase of shares or debentures of a company. Okay, when you are making a prospectus, is merely an advertisement. Okay, that is called a prospectus. The prospectus consists of all the activities and all the things which are related with the company. Okay, and also the registration of prospectus is important under section 60. Okay, these are all comes under shares and share capital. What are different types of shares, class of shares means got up equity share, preference shares, deferred shares. So all this comes under, easily you can read that different kinds of shares, that is called cumulative preference shares, non cumulative preference shares, redeemable preference shares, irredeemable preference shares. Okay. So it's a vast, vast part. That is why I'm just skipping off all those things. Okay. We just read that these things in a. And then next to the lesson is debenture. Debenture, what is debenture? Debenture which includes the stock, bonds or any securities whether constituting a charge on the assets of the company. Okay, what is the difference between the share and the debentures? Debentures are the, what is that? Debentures. What is the difference between shares and debenture? Do you know anybody?
Yes, sir. If you purchase the share of a company, we can become a owner of that company. But if we purchase the debenture, we cannot be the owner of that company.
It is a paper debenture. It is also an instrument from which you are getting the interest. It's just like a loan, okay. Whereas from the share capital, you are going to get a dividend out of it, okay. For a certain reason or after certain closed, that shares means if you are getting a shares from the share, from that company, you are become a owner of the company, okay. And then different classes of shares, class of debentures. And these are all the main things which are come in this debentures. Okay. And this is about the directors. How many directors are required for a company and for which how much of remuneration, what are the qualifications, what are the disqualifications of directors? You just read it. You just read all those things. Qualification and a disqualification of directors. The director must be an individual. Share capital, share qualification. He must hold certain amount of shares from a company. He is an eligible person to become a share director of the company. Okay, according to this articles. Disqualification means a person who's of unsound mind, insolvent, who is an insolvent person, and he is not holding that qualified shares. So these are some of the disqualification of directors, okay, for which how much of period he can what is the maximum amount of remuneration they can get it from the company. That is the remuneration not exceeding 11%. So these are the certain things which will come in this chapter, in this lesson. What are the liabilities, what are the duties of the directors? And then finally, what is meeting and resolution? What are the different meetings, different kinds of meeting? I already told that statutory meeting, annual general statutory meetings are the meetings which have been conducted once in the once in the lifetime of the business of a company. Okay, that is called a statutory meeting. These kind of meetings cannot be done for every year or every now and then. It's a one-time meeting. That is called a statutory meeting, and then annual general meeting. This has been conducted every year, and then extraordinary general meeting, class meeting, okay, meeting by directors, that is meeting of board of directors, meeting of committee of directors, meeting of creditors, debenture holders and contributories. So these are the different types of meetings. What is the procedure in meeting? How many members which have been needed for a meeting? What are the resolutions which have been passed? Whether it is having a special resolution or ordinary resolution? What are the things which have been needed? What is the minutes how you are going to write? Or what is a quorum? So these are all come under this chapter, this lesson. What is special? What I told you is called what is special resolution. What is ordinary resolutions? All it should be explained here. accounts audit and prevention and operational mismanagement. And another important lesson is binding up. That is also an important thing. This is when you are forming a company at a binding up means it's going to close down a company. On what ground? In what ground you are going to close the company? Okay. Sometimes you can close by the way of court. Okay. Close by the way of court. That we can call as a compulsory winding up. As it often is called, it is initiated by an application by the petition presented to the court for winding up order. Okay. In certain cases, we may go to the court and winding up. Because of several reasons. If the company is unable to pay its debts and shareholders are not in a position to do a business, and the court in his opinion is you are not doing the correct legal product in the company. Like that, we have a lot of reasons for which the compulsory winding up can be takes place. And then sometimes even voluntary winding up means it is a certain period. You are doing a company for a certain task, certain objective. If the objectives may be achieved in a particular period of time, finally you may go voluntarily, and finally you can according to the ordinary resolution of the shareholders. Or sometimes it may pass on the one special resolution through which you can wind up. So, okay, you can close the company. Okay, that kind of winding up is called voluntary winding up. Okay. And then at the time of winding up the company, what did happen? You have to pay to the shareholders, debenture holders, who are all creditors, who are all needed, or who are all the contributories for your company. For that, you need to pay for it. So at the time, the one person who is to be appointed by the court, or you the company itself, and appoint a person look after the activities for the settlement of money. That person is called a liquidator. Official liquidator, which have been for when you are going for an compulsory winding up. The High Court itself, they will appoint an official liquidator. That person, what is the responsibility? What is the power? What is the duty for the liquidator means? That liquidator is a person who is take over the assets, and he will arrange for that for the selling of the assets, through which they should settle down the creditors amount, and then liabilities, all the liabilities of that company. And one of the main thing about the liquidators means they should first of all settle the external liabilities first of all. Then finally, only the shareholders, if the money is available, then only the shareholders can get the money. Okay, these are the formalities which have been done by the liquidator. For that liquidators is getting certain amount of remuneration. That remuneration called liquidator's remuneration. Certain percentage of amount which have been given for the official liquidator. Okay, so these are the main duties of a liquidator. Okay, up to this unit was over. Okay, next final unit is called a Factories Act. Under this Factories Act, what is factory? What are the objectives of factory? The main objectives of Factories Act of 1946 means to improve the health, welfare, safety of the workman who is working in a factory. And second important objective is to regulate by imposing restriction to hours of work, including rest and provision of availing of leave. That is because of this Factories Act only that total time, working time per day has been reduced to 8 hours. Before that, it is been 11 hours. 10 to 11 hours is takes place in the factory. But only the according to this Factories Act only it has been reduced to 8 hours. And to make a stringent provisions as regard employment of women and young persons and duration of their work. So these are the main objectives for which this Factories Act was formed. What are the rights of worker? What is occupier? What is the licensing and registration of factory? How it is takes place? All this comes in this chapter. This is about working hours, holidays, and annual leaves. Okay.
Hello, sir. Is it important to study section number?
What's that? Tell me.
Is it important to study section number?
Not clear. What you told is not clear.
Sir, is important to study section number, like section 6?
Yes. It's the fifth.
Yeah, sir.
Next act is called Industrial Disputes Act. Industrial Disputes Act. Well, when you are the employer-employee relationship, about the employee-employee relationship, there will be some kind of a dispute source takes place between the employer-employee at the time of wages, and there will be some problem with the employer and the employee. In that cases, there will be some act which was formed. Definitely the employers are exploiting their employees. So at the time, there will be some disputes was takes place among them. So in that cases, how this it has been resolved? How it has been resolved? So for that resolution purpose only, this act was formed in order to improve the industrial relations. Okay. Here in these objects of this object of this act, they are given that promoting measures for securing and preserving amity of good relation between employer and employee, and inquiring into any matter connected with or relevant to an industrial dispute. Okay. And third one is promoting the settlement of industrial disputes and adjudication of industrial disputes, reference of industrial disputes to grievance settlement authorities, and voluntary reference of a disputes to attribution, prevention of illegal strikes and lockouts, compensation for layoff and retrenchment of workmen, and prevention of unfair labor practices, and the provision of payment of wages, minimum pay wages. So these are the main important thing. Actually, this is about according to the social justice, you have to make a, without making any disputes, it has been secured for the security purpose, for the secureness of the workers in the factory. This act was formed. Okay. Minimum of average pay, how many workers or workmen is needed to work, what is about industry. So all those things which is come under this unit. Okay. This is cause of dispute. So you just see that diagram. Cause of dispute, by the way, of financial, non-financial. Financial causes like wages, bonus, DA, traveling allowance, leave with pay, gratuity, holiday with pay, promotion and transfer, non-financial causes, transport, housing, education, working hours, working condition, discipline, recreation facility, like that. Okay. Effects of industrial disputes, strike, layoff, lockout, retrenchment. So these are the problem closure. So these are the effects of a industry disputes. Regarding any problem which have been arised in a factory, this will be, it has been settled down in this, in the Industrial Disputes Act. All should be come in this Industrial Disputes Act. This is about the machinery of a prevention and settlement of industrial disputes. How they are going to settle down the industrial disputes. Okay, this will come in this topic. And then I already told that Minimum Wages Act 1948. You have for in that Minimum Wages Act, this is the minimum amount for which you have to pay for the employees. Before that, they are not having the minimum wages. Even they will give a very, very lesser amount. For somebody else, they are giving a more amount. So there will be a no standard wages for employees. So after that only this act was formed. According to that minimum wages, these are the certain minimum wages has been fixed accordingly that the factories, the companies are giving the wages. This is has been done by the according to the cost of living of takes place in the particular area. Okay. That is fixation, revision of minimum wages. And then Workmen Compensation Act 1923. Actually, Workmen Compensation is nothing but when you are going for a retirement or when you are providing a medical treatment or any injury or certain things or takes place, when you are going for a VRS, that is voluntary retirement scheme, at the time how that workman compensation was to be done, all those things which will come under this act. Okay, these are the main areas that is almost we will touch. That is, I do not say that we will see all the things in a deeper manner. We will touch to all the areas. Okay, up to this, the 5 units was over. Okay. If you have
any question,
ask me. Okay, and then I will give important questions. Okay, tell me, ask me.
Okay, sir, I ask you that is important to study section number agreement section 2, subsection H, like that.
That is given in the book. You just read that section. Okay.
Okay, is it for 1 mark in question paper?
If it is possible, you write it in that way, or otherwise you just away straight away you write the without section also, you can write it, no problem. Okay
sir.
These are the important questions, please take down that. I just read it. First, explain the business environment and its types. I initially explained about what is business environment, what are the different types, internal environment, external environment. That definitely a definite question. And second one is what is social responsibility, what is ethics, so that which are important for the business. Which is come in the unit number 1, we just read it, and then explain the different types of economic system. What is that? Mixed economy, public capitalist economy, okay, socialistic economy. So these are the different types of economy that you have to explain in an elaborate way. Okay, and then fourth one is evaluate and the impact of globalization. So tell me.
Sir, that is the kinds of the economic system, no, sir? Economy system.
Thanks.
So then there is only 3 kinds, no? Free, government, and mixed.
Mixed, yes.
That yes. 3 is enough, or also the subdivisions we have to write?
You write it, no problem. You just write it. Even the subdivisions, you write it. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Sir, can you just confirm how many are there, till where it is there?
No, actually, mainly only 3. Okay. 3 after that you are going for a subtopic means you write it, no problem for that. Okay,
okay, then that 3 is the main, right?
Main. Yes, 3 is the main.
Okay, so thank you.
Next one is evaluate the impact of globalization, privatization. I explained in the at the time of explanation what is globalization, what is privatization, how it is takes place, what are the ways in which the globalization takes place, what are the privatization, what are the routes through which the privatization takes place in our Indian economy. Okay, so all those things you I did. And then fifth one is outline the present status of infrastructure facilities in our country. That is about electricity, roadways, railways, waterways. So different infrastructure facilities that I explained in the unit number 2. Okay, so that infrastructure facilities, what is the present status? Present status is needed. Okay, you even which is some of the main thing which have been given in the book, or otherwise you can collect the materials from the net, from internet. Just from Google, you just collect the present status of energy, and then electricity, and then roadways, all the things you just get it from the Google. Okay, and the next one is evaluate the role played by the MNC in the developing countries. Okay, what is about MNC, how much of MNCs which have been, this is about current topics. Okay, so what are the MNCs, what are the MNCs which is available in India, what are the major roles which have been in the particular sector, for example, for in an a car sector, what are the different MNCs, what are the software sectors, what are the different kinds of MNCs are available in India, which is doing a major part for the contribution of our economy. So all these things just explain it. Okay, next one is for explain the concept of financial and technical collaborations. A lot of financial and technical collaborations have been done by different MNCs. Okay, so accordingly you just see that areas and explain it. And next thing is called about the law. That is, explain the essential elements of valid contract. I just explained yesterday what are the different kinds of essential elements of, that is, offer and acceptance, legal, competent parties, legality, object, and then legal objects, and then a legal person, like that. We have almost nine essential elements are there. You just explain it. And then difference between the coercion and undue influence. Okay. So these are all comes under, while concerned with the free consent. Free consent. While you are entering into a contract, it must be free consent. If the contract which have been not having a free consent only, here this coercion and undue influence will come. Okay. And explain the various modes of discharge of contract that I explained today. I just did. What are the discharge, how the discharge of contract has been takes place, and they explain the various ways of creation of agency, and then what is difference between sale and agreement to sale, explain the characteristics of bill of exchange, define company, explain the characteristics of a company, and what are the different types of company, the difference between the shares and stock, types of share capital that I told. What is the different types of share capital? Equity share capital, preference share capital. So these are the main two types of share capital. In that preference share capital, we are having a different classifications, like a preference share capital, and the preference share capital, cumulative preference share, non-cumulative preference share, participative preference share, non-participative preference shares, redeemable preference shares, non-redeemable preference shares. Okay, so these are the different types of share capital. Cumulative preference shares is nothing but, what is that? You can able to cumulate your dividend up to certain extent. Okay, that is called cumulative preference shares. Non-cumulative means you cannot able to cumulate. Cumulate is nothing but add. Okay, you cannot able to add. So that kind of share called cumulative or non-cumulative. Participative means, participative preference share means those preference shareholders, if after giving all the amount to the other shareholders like equity shareholders and preference shareholders, there will be some extra profit will be available. So at the time of extra profit, the only those participative preference shareholders can participate that extra dividend, extra amount which is available, you can get the dividend. Okay, that kind of preference share capital is called a participative preference share. Non-participative preference share means you are not able to participate. You are not able to participate in the extra profit. Okay, that is called a non-participative preference shares. And finally, redeemable and non-redeemable. Redeemable means actually in the redeemable preference shares, at initially itself they told that while issuing the shares, they told to the redeemable preference shareholders, after 5 years or 10 years, we will redeem it. Redeem it means we will take back the shares from you. For at the time, how much of a value, accordingly we will pay it, and then you have to return back your share capital. Okay, so at that, after 5 years or 10 years, how much of value in the present situation, they will pay that amount to the different shareholders, they will take back their shares. Okay, that kind of method which should be adopted in the case of redeemable preference shares, whereas in the non-redeemable preference shares, it cannot be happen. Okay, so these are the different types of shares. And then define director. What is director? Director is a person who is appointed for running a business. Minimum number of directors, how many minimum number of directors? Minimum at least 2 directors which is be needed. Okay, so that about that, what is the qualification? I told her, what is the qualification? He is a sound person, he is a competent person, he must have required share capital from that company. At least 10% of share capital should be held in that in the hands of that director. So like that, there will be some certain qualifications are needed. And what are disqualifications? Disqualifications means if he is a non-competent person, means he's not eligible person to become a director. Okay, and then even certain period, if he is acted as a director, finally the special resolution or ordinary resolution which have been given in the meeting to cancel their job or their work, means even you will become a disqualified person as a director. So like that, we have a lot of disqualifications things over there about the directors. And meeting, what is the meeting, what are different types of meetings, extraordinary general meeting, annual general meeting, statutory meeting. Okay, so these are the meetings. So that meetings, you have to explain it, and then explain and enumerate the procedure of licensing the practice that I told. What are the procedures which have been followed? While another thing that I not put it in the the questions, that is formation of company. Formation of company is also important. Another question that you just added, what is that? Characteristics of a company. What is company? A defined company. Characteristics. What are the different characteristics of company? Characteristics of company and formation of company. That is, I explained that when you are going to form a company, who are all the main persons? Promoter. Promoter is a person who is look after the operation of starting a business. Okay, and then that registration is to be takes place with the help of this memorandum of association and articles of association. After after getting registered, you are getting in commencement of business and certificate of incorporation, and then you are getting the certificate of commencement of business, and finally you start a business. Okay, like that, a certain procedure for the formation of company. Like that also in the factory also, while going for starting of company, there will be some procedure. You must go for the registration, you must clear the pollution control board. Whether you are starting a business in that urban area, rural area, in that panchayat, you have to get a certificate. Like that, a lot of license licensing facilities and registration facilities are available. You just read that procedures, okay? So that procedures will be come in this and this method. And what are the provisions under the industrial disputes and settlement of industrial disputes? While going for industrial disputes, how that the industrial disputes has been settled? That will, what are the provisions that have been done in this settlement of industrial disputes? And another important question is called, what is liquidator? How, what is the duties of liquidator? Okay. And then next, state the procedure prescribed under the Act of Claiming or Disbursing the Compensation under the Workmen Compensation Act. Okay, so these are the certain areas, certain things, certain important questions. It may ask. Okay, it is around 20 to 25 questions that I explained, that I told. You just read, you just touch all the areas, means. Even if you read all the 20 or 24 questions or 25 questions, means definitely, I have a confidence that definitely 10 questions to 15 questions they will ask, definitely will come. Why? Because I just touched all the main areas. So according to from that area only, definitely most of the questions may ask. So don't worry, you just and another important thing, while writing your examinations, one main thing that I want to insist, while we are going on valuation, mostly the presentation is very important. Presentation of paper is very important. Okay, how you are going to present, one of the main thing that you have to present is by the way of while starting your answer, you just create a diagrammatic presentation like rules or routes and arrows, through which you just make a graphic presentation, and then you can write the answers. So while presenting in that way, that will give a good impression that you are having a in-depth knowledge. For example, I explain the essential elements of valid contract. If you know that what are the essential elements of valid contract, you can remember it, means you can write all the 10 points first of all, and then you explain it. You just explain it. Nine points. Essential elements of offer and acceptance, legality, legal objects, consideration, pre-consent. So you just write it by the way of any arrow or by the way of rounds or like that. You just give a presentation first of all. You must give a good presentation. And then you write it. So this kind of presentation, this kind of things, you may get a very good marks. Even though you are getting a good marks, but that is my request for getting a good marks. Okay. So it is almost we will touch some of the main areas. In certain areas that we cannot able to touch it because of shortage of time, or if you have any question, just please ask me. Are you taken down this questions?
Yes, sir.
Huh?
Yes, sir.
You ask me any question. Okay, if you want any question, please ask me.
Sir, in future, if we find any doubt, can we contact you?
Okay, no problem. Definitely contact me.
Yeah, how to contact you, sir? You are there in the group?
No, I am not in the group. Actually, you create a group, first of all. If you're having a group?
Yeah, we already there is a group now created by the Pondicherry.
Okay, no problem. From that group, definitely I will inform to the madam. Inform to the madam that definitely they will send you all the questions, all the areas. That will be helpful for you. Okay. I just inform the madam that she will give all the details. Okay. If I'm given the PPT, that PPT is definitely I will send it to him. I'll send it to him. She will give all those things. Okay.
Hello, sir. What is the difference between void contract and illegal agreement?
What is the difference between void contract?
Void contract and illegal agreement.
Void contract. Void contracts or the contract, I already told that is not enforceable by law. Not enforceable by law. But illegal contract means from the name itself, they are clearly mentioned that it is illegal. This is illegal. If you are making a contract with the illegal person who is doing an illegal job or illegal work, from that you are doing some kind of contract is called illegal contract. Okay.
Illegal agreement.
You are making an agreement with an illegal person for an illegal work. Okay. So that kind of agreement is called illegal agreement. That illegal agreement is considered to become a void. Void.
Okay, sir.
Okay. If you have any questions, please ask me, or otherwise I will close it. Madam, it is available? Are you available? Are you in the line? And one main area that definitely law is very important. Okay, laws and the second from the third unit there are different laws are there. The law that is contract law, company or factories act law. So and then formation of company. So these are the main areas. They will ask a very good important question in that area. Okay, from the first and second part. Some of the main, these are all the main areas, but only 3 to 4 questions may ask. Okay, that is why we just concentrate after the third unit. That will be more helpful for you while writing a examination. Okay, thank you for proper listening my class, as well as questions that you are arised. Thank you for the participation. Thank you once again.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everyone.